إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد عليه الصلاة والسلام، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل دلالة في النار. وبعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. I'd first like to say that I'm very happy to be back to my hometown. It was a good feeling being on the train, I guess if you haven't been away from the place that you were born and you grew up in, and people who you love and you cherish, as a kafir, and then coming into Islam, and then having more justification for loving and cherishing them, and then having the feeling that you know you're getting closer and closer and closer to those people, to the place where those people are in a large group. If you haven't been away and been able to do this, I guess you would not be able to empathize with me or to share how I feel getting off the Amtrak this morning and coming here. Because I miss each and every one of you, even those whom may have problems with some things that we believe and say and do. I miss all of you for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, especially in a place where it's extremely boring and I don't do anything but stay in the house all day. Today we'd like to talk a little bit about, and we're going to talk only a short moment inshallah, because of the qadr of Allah and the qada of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I was late, even though I've been here since 10:30. We'd like to talk about qada'ullah wa rida bih. We'd like to talk about the decree of Allah and having contentment with the decree of Allah. But before we begin, there's a hadith that we find in the collection of Al-Bukhari that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and there's some other narrations similar to this, where somebody asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, ayyun nas ashaddul bala'. Ayyun nas ashaddul bala'. They asked the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who or what people have the severest of trials? What people, which of the human beings has the most severest of trials? Ayyun nas ashaddul bala', ashaddul bala'. What human beings have the most difficult of all trials? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, al-anbiya'u. He said, the prophet. And the first time I read this hadith, even after reading the explanation, because sometimes you can read the explanation of something, but if you don't have something to connect it with in your personal life, even if the ulama explain it to you, you don't have clarity sometimes. Unless sometimes, theoretically it's clear, but unless something has actually happened to you, sometimes things don't click. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, al-anbiya'u, thumma al-amthalu fal-amthal. He said, then the ones who have the worst in trials or the most severe of trials after the Prophet, I said, thumma al-amthalu, then the ones who are similar to them, فَالْأَمْثَلُ, and the ones who are similar to them. And I started thinking about this hadith. It was a few months ago. when I read it again, I started thinking about this hadith. And I started thinking about what we say every single day in Al-Fatiha. Every single day in Al-Fatiha, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, اهدنا الصراط المستقيم. Oh Allah, we request of you, we invoke you, we beg you to guide us on the straight way, the right path, the path of guidance. صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم. The path of those whom you have given your ni'mah. أنعمت, أنت Allah, يا ربي, أنعمت عليهم. The one whom you, those individuals, the path that I want to be on, are the individuals whom you have sent down on them your ni'mah. Then when we go to the explanation of this ayah in Surah Al-Fatiha, the surah that's called Ummul Kitab, and other, quite a few other names. When we go to the tafsir of this ayah, we'll see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained this ayah, and the Sahaba who were with him and after him after he died, radiallahu anhum ajma'een, they explained this ayah that those whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given his ni'mah are al-nabiyyin, wa-siddiqeen, wa-shuhada, wa-saliheen. The prophets, al-nabiyyin, which is al-anbiya, wa-siddiqeen, and the extremely truthful people, and who should also be believed as being truthful, wa-shuhada, who are the scholars and the martyrs. The scholars and the martyrs. Not just the martyrs, but the scholars and the martyrs. Wa-saliheen, and those who are extremely righteous, and they associate with the people who are righteous. They're extremely righteous themselves, and they associate with the people who are righteous. So when we think about this particular ayah, at least 17 times a day, every single day, in the fara'id, in the faridah salah, the fard salah, in the salat al-sunnah, in the salat al-nawafil, the supererogatory or optional prayers, there's no salah without al-fatiha. Every single day that we make a salah, istikhara, tahiyatul masjid, salatul duha, salatul tahajjud, no matter what salah it is, we ask Allah to put us on the path of those upon whom He has given His ni'mah. And the first of the four categories are the people whom the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said have the worst and the most severe of trials. So every single day, and when I connected them in my mind, and this wasn't from something I read, this is just something from my own mind, the way I understood it, to apply it. We are asking to be with the people who have the severest of punishment, or severest of trials, excuse me. The people who have the most severest of trials, every single day we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be with them in their company. This is what we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if this is the case, every day, because when sometimes I think when we read, we recite Al-Fatiha, we don't think, we just asking Allah for His ni'mah. We don't think about the other part that goes along with those people who receive the ni'mah, which is ibtila, which is trials and tribulations. Every day we're asking Allah, we're actually asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to put us with the people who are tested, who are given trials, who are given tribulations. And in order for us to get that ni'mah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given the Nabiyyin, the Al-Anbiya, we have to realize that a package deal is involved. That to get that ni'mah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have to be tested. And as a part of being tested, and as a part of being tried, no matter what type of trial it is, we have to be pleased with the decree of Allah in order to get that ni'mah that we ask for. اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم. In order to get that ni'mah, we have to undergo those trials. If we want to be with those people, we keep asking Allah, we want to be with them. It's just a logical conclusion. If you really want to be with the prophets, if you really want to be with the shuhada, if you really want to be with the siddiqeen or the shuhada and the salihin, whom the Prophet ﷺ said, that the most severe in trials are al-anbiya. Al-anbiya, thumma al-amthalu fal-amthal. Or fal-amthal, thumma al-amthalu fal-amthal.
those who are similar to them and those who are similar to them. And look at the Sahaba. The Sahaba, radiallahu anhum ajma'in. They were the most severe of people that Allah created in trials. The most severe. Look at Al-Khabbab ibn al-Arat, radiallahu anhum. One of the many Sahaba who were tortured. One of the many Sahaba, male and female, who were tortured. We all know his story. How he would take it out into the desert on some days when it's very hot. And he was put, a suit of armor was put around his body while he was naked. And the steel or the metal would press against his flesh until it peeled off the skin from his chest and his back. This is something that he asked Allah for by saying, اِهْدِينَ الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. He's asking Allah. What's the proof? Because he's asking Allah to be with the people whom, oh Allah, you've given the ni'mah, and the people who Allah gives the ni'mah to are the people called the prophets. So the most tested people, the most tortured people, the people who undergo the most trials after the prophets of Allah, are the Sahaba, the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because they are the best of people after the prophets, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after the prophets and messengers of Allah. Then those people who come after them, like the Tabi'un. Then those people who come after them, like the Itba'u Tabi'een. And all the way down to our lives, for those people who want to practice the Quran and the Sunnah on the manhaj of As-Salaf As-Salih. Those people who want to stick to the manhaj of our rightly guided predecessors, who were the worst, the most severe in being tested by Allah after the Prophet. This, brothers and sisters, is what we ask in Allah for every single day. And when it comes, we also have to imitate and emulate those individuals when they're tested by the pleasure of whatever Allah decrees. Or, even though we're being tortured, even though we're being oppressed, even though we're being terrorized, even though we're under tyranny, even though we're being killed, we will not get the ni'mah until we're pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has determined for us. And the proof for this again is in the same hadith when Khabbab ibn al-Arat radiallahu anhu came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he asked the Prophet, أَلَا تَنْتَصِرُوا أَلَا تَدْعُوا اللَّهَ لَنَا. Won't you seek victory for us? Won't you ask Allah to give us help? Won't you make dua to Allah for us? Because we've been tortured. While the Prophet was leaning on his burda and his cloak under the shade of the Kaaba. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam started the hadith that we all know, that there used to be a time where a man, a hole was dug for him, and he was placed in the hole, and his head, a saw was brought, and his head was split in half, and that didn't deter him from his deen until the end of the hadith, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Walakin, or walakin nakum tasta'jilun," but you people are just too impatient. See, we ask Allah every day in Al-Fatiha for this ni'mah, but when the other part that makes us be in the company of those people on Yawm al-Qiyamah comes, we bug out, we get frustrated, we lie to each other, we slander each other, we cheat each other, we separate from each other, we don't want to bear the trial that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered us to beg Him for, to be with those prophets and the things that they got. أَيُّ النَّاسِ أَشَدُّ الْبَلَىٰ. Which of the people are the most severe in trial? The prophets. But we don't really want to be with them. We don't really want to be with them. Because we turn to narcotics. We turn to alcohol abuse. We turn to beating our wives. Some of us beat our husbands. Because you got a big thing now in America, even among the Muslims. Husband abuse. They have husband shelters. Husband abuse shelters in the United States now. I don't know if you brothers know about that. No, they do. It's not a joke. They have husband abuse, shelters where husbands are being beat by their husbands. By their wives. And what? They may have that too. I don't know. But this is something that's serious. But what the point is, brothers, is that I don't think we really realize that all of these things are package deals. If we really want to be with those people on Yawm al-Qiyamah at the place of gathering, then everything that they went through, we have to go through it too. If we really want to be with them, we have to undergo these things, and we have to be pleased with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has determined. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentions in a hadith that is a Hassan hadith, alhamdulillah, and you can find it in the Muslim Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. He said, "Inna 'idham al-jaza' ma'a 'udhm al-bala', wa inna Allah idha ahabba qauman ibtalahum. Faman radiya falahu ar-ridha, wa man sakhata falahu as-sakhat." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that the tremendousness of the reward or the recompense goes along with the tremendousness of the trial. The tremendousness of the trial. The tremendousness of the reward goes with the tremendousness of the trial. When Allah loves a people, He tries them. When Allah loves a people, He tries them. He gives them ibtila. He tries them. Whoever is pleased with this trial, this ibtila, this imtihan, this ikhtibar from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this tribulation, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be pleased with him. And whoever has displeasure with the decree of Allah, and we need to know the difference between the qadr and the qadha. The qadr of Allah is that which was written in the preserved tablet, and that which occurs of that which was written is the qadha. This is the difference between the qadr and the qadha. And that's why some people have a misunderstanding when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that the dua, nothing changes the decree of Allah except dua. It's not changing what was written, it changes the occurrence of what is written. It changes the occurrence of what is written. And this is the topic today. Being pleased and content with the occurrence of what was written. Being pleased with the occurrence of that which was written. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "وَمَنْ سَخَطَ فَلَهُ سَخَطَ." And whoever is displeased, then he will have displeasure. Meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be displeased with him. We also have the hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "يُبْتَلَى الرَّجُلُ عَلَى حَسْبِ دِينِهِ فَإِنْ كَانَ فِي دِينِهِ طُلْبًا اشْتَدَّ الْبَلَاءُهُ." He said that the person is tested. He's tried by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala according to the level of his deen. According to the level of his deen. فَإِنْ كَانَ فِي دِينِهِ طُلْبًا اشْتَدَّ بِلَاءُهُ. And if he has reached that state of realization where he has the position where he knows that there's nothing whatsoever that he could have done about what occurred, then Allah increases the trial. If he realizes that there's nothing he could have done by the decision that the Shaykh gave him about the khula that he asked, or his wife asked from him. His wife asked for a khula, so he accepted it. Now he finds regret and remorse. He has to accept what the Shaykh said. You can't go back to her. The only way you can get her back is after the iddah. She has to come back to you through the wali. And then you have to have another marriage, you know, the acceptance and offerings, a new dowry, a new two witnesses again, at least, etc. He has to handle it. He has to agree with it. So Allah increases it. He increases the trial on the human being. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "When كَانَ فِي دِينِهِ رِقَّةٌ أُبْتُلِيَ عَلَى قَدْرِ دِينِهِ." And basically what this means is, if he's on a lower level, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tries him, Allah will try him. He will try him according to the lowness of his deen. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tries every individual according to their stance, their status, and their deen. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "فَمَا يَبْرَحُ الْبَلَاءُ بِالْعَبْدِ حَتَّى يَتْرُكُهُ يَمْشِي عَلَى الْعَرْضِ وَمَا عَلَيْهِ خَطِيئَةٌ." And the suffering doesn't depart the slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala until he's totally cleansed of all his sins. The suffering does not let up. It continues and it continues and it continues. The trial continues until al-abd, the slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is completely cleansed of his sins. Completely. So brothers and sisters, if we really, really understood, and maybe many of us do, this thing called the decree of Allah, and being pleased with the decree of Allah, and being satisfied and content, being content with what Allah has determined, then we will have a great reward with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in his book, وَلُنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَالنَّقْصٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ قَالُوا إِنَّ لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّ إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَيْهِمْ صَلَوَاتٌ مِّن رَّبِّهِمْ وَرَحْمَةٌ وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُهْتَدُونَ. Surely we will try them, or try you, of something of fear, al-khawf, and al-jur, and hunger, and loss of lives, and crop, and property, but give glad tidings to the patient, that when those are the individuals, that when they are struck with a musibah, when they are hit with some misfortune or calamity, they say, we belong to Allah, and to Allah we will all return. They are the ones that get two things from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They get salawat, they get salat from Allah, and they get rahmah. And the salat is not like salatul zuhr, or salatul asr, or maghrib. The salawat here means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives them. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives them. And they get rahmah from Allah. Mercy from Allah. They are the muhtadun. They are the ones who are guided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? It's because they recognize that Allah is afflicting them. They are patient in it. And they are pleased with it. As the Prophet said in the other hadith, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What's the difference between a sabr, or the relationship between a sabr and rida? Patience and contentment. The relationship of sabr with rida is that rida or contentment is higher than sabr. And when I was thinking about this word, the English word patient, I always wondered why they call the person who's sick in the hospital a patient. Maybe, Allahu A'lam, Allah knows best. Maybe it is because that person is undergoing some type of suffering and he's at the mercy of those individuals, doctors and nurses, to heal him or her. So they call him a patient. And this is what we have to have. But higher than that is having rida, being content that you're sick and you're in the hospital. And that's not easy. To learn that you have leukemia, it's easy to be patient with it, but to be content with that is very, very difficult. It's very, very difficult to find out that you are HIV positive. It's very difficult to deal with that. Being patient can be easy, but being content is very difficult. It's very, very difficult. And if we want to be with those individuals called Al-Anbiya, this is what we have to have, brothers and sisters in Islam. We have to be content with the decree of Allah. Now some of the ulama, alhamdulillah, they've given us some guidelines pertaining to this issue of contentment. And the ulama, alhamdulillah, rahimahumullah, may Allah have mercy on all of them. They say that this decree of Allah, the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or the thing that he has decreed, falls into two basic categories. There's al-maqdi shara'an and al-maqdi kawnan. Al-maqdi shara'an is the thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed that is from his wahi, from his revelation. There's nothing we could have done about it, and we have to, it's wajib for us to be content with it. Like for instance, the five daily prayers. This is a decreed matter by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we have to be pleased that Allah has made the five daily prayers obligatory on us. We have to be content with this. We can't have discontentment and displeasure with the five daily prayers being obligatory on us. We also have to be pleased and content with the fact that Allah has made riba haram. We have to. It's wajib on us. We also have to be content that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made zina haram. There's no way getting around it. It's not optional. We have to have contentment with these things. But there's some other things, like al-maqdi kawnan. These are some things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has left for us to either A, be obligated to have contentment with, or B, not be obligated. Where it falls into those things that are mustahab, that is highly recommended. For instance, a person, as we mentioned just moments ago, becomes sick. A person becomes sick. Do we have to be pleased with the sickness, or is it mustahab? There's a difference of opinion among the ulama, in two opinions. Some say, no, you have to be pleased that you have AIDS. You have to be. And some of the ulama say, no, it's mustahab. That you don't necessarily have to be pleased with it, but you have to believe that it came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And according to Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullah, and this seems to be, and Allah knows best, the strongest of opinions, is that it's mustahab, it's highly recommended to be pleased with these types of things, like the loss of property, the loss of a child, sickness, the loss of money, etc. The ulama go on. They say that there are four things, four states or conditions that the human being has pertaining to his displeasure with the decree of Allah. The first is a sakht. And we mentioned this word in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Sakht meaning a strong dislike or displeasure. The ulama say as follows. These are the things that, for instance, are haram from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to believe that they are not from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and have displeasure with them. Or, you know that they're from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and He has made them forbidden and you have displeasure in the fact that they're haram. Like, for instance, drinking alcohol. A Muslim does not like the fact that drinking alcohol is haram, then he falls into this category. He doesn't have the choice. Some of the ulama, as a proof, when someone dies and we're not pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's decree that we lose someone, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, لَيْسَ مِنَّ مَنْ ضَرَبَ الْخُدُودِ وَشَقَّ الْزُيُوبِ وَدَعَ بِدَعَوَ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ. He said that they are not of us who beat their cheeks, who rip their clothes, and give out calls of the people of Jahiliyyah or the calls from the time of Jahiliyyah. And unfortunately, we have this in Islam today. We have people who have adopted the ways of the kuffar, who imitate the kuffar, and they hire people to do this in some Muslim countries. They hire people, professional mourners, just like the kuffar. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that these people are not of us. It doesn't mean that they're kuffar. It means they're not following the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The second of those categories is as-sabr. Being patient. The ulama say about this that when a person has pain from some type of musibah, from some type of misfortune or calamity, but he's patient and he doesn't say anything from his tongue, he doesn't say anything that negates that patience, or he doesn't do anything with his limbs that negates that patience, and he withholds having any thoughts in his chest about those particular things, and he says, Allahumma ajurni fi musibati wa khluf li khayrun minhu. Allahumma ajurni fi musibati وَخْلُفْ لِي خَيْرًا مِنْهُ. He will get a great reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is, oh Allah, compensate me in my misfortune and give me something better than it. As Salama radiallahu anha, she was married to Abu Salama radiallahu anhu, and he died fi sabilillah. And he was one of the better of the Sahaba, one of the eminent Sahaba. And he died in the early days of Islam. And she was mourning him, and she was grieving over him. But she was patient, alhamdulillah. And the Prophet, because she didn't know which way to turn, because there was no one outside of the Messenger of Allah that was better than her husband. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told her to say, "Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Allahumma ajurni fi musibati wa khluf li khayran minhu." To Allah we belong, to Allah we will all return. Oh Allah, compensate me. Give me, compensate me, and give me something better in my misfortune than what I had. And she married the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So her patience is one fourth of those things that the ulama say it is a necessity for us to have the rida, to have the contentment with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The third is the actual contentment itself. The ulama say about this that it is mustahab to have this contentment in areas that are not divinely revealed aspects of our deen. It's mustahab, as we mentioned earlier. Things outside of the obligatory acts. Things that we have some leeway in saying something about them, or some option of accepting them. For instance, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's mentioned the case of his wife Khadija radiallahu anha. When Khadija asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "What is the destiny, for lack of better words, of the two children that I had before Islam? What is the destiny of those children before Islam?" And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I guess you can imagine how she felt when he told her this, because the Messenger of Allah does not speak of his own desire. He said, "Innahuma fi an-nar," that both of them are in the hellfire. And I must remind us, both of these children, this is the added note, both of these children didn't reach puberty. Neither of these two children reached puberty. And the sisters who are listening, I want you to listen even more attentively than the brothers. These two children didn't reach puberty. This should tell us something about this misconception or this false notion that we have, that just because a child is born or dies and it hasn't reached puberty, it's going to Jannah. This is a gross error. So then she asked him, because as Ali radiallahu anhu, who was the narrator of the hadith in the Musnad Imam Ahmad, Ali said, and he saw the displeasure in her face, she asked him, "What about our child? What about our child?" And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Innahu fil jannah," that he is in Jannah. That he is in Jannah. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Inna al-mu'minina wa awladahum fil jannah, wa inna al-mushrikeena wa awladahum fil nar." Surely the believers and their children are in Jannah. Surely the mushrikun and their children are in a hellfire. She had to have pleasure with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's Prophet had told her about her children. She had to. She had to have this pleasure. And lastly, the scholars of Islam, they tell us that you have to have a shukr, that you have to give thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for what He has decreed. For what He has decreed. If we, and this is a strange thing for the Muslims, how in the world am I to develop myself to be thankful for what Allah has decreed when it is against me? I've lost my job, I've lost my wife, I've lost my property, my house burned down, and I have to be thankful. Or I should be thankful. How do I do this? What's the reward for it? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ قالوا إن لله وإن إليه راجعون أولئك عليهم صلوات من ربهم ورحمة وأولئك هم المهتدون. The ayah that we recited earlier. And give glad tidings to the patient. Those whom when they are afflicted by this misfortune, they are the ones who say we belong to Allah and to Allah we will return. They are the ones who receive the salawat and the rahmah from their Lord, and they are the ones who are guided. So this is a reward that they get for being thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says, إِنَّمَا يُوَفَّى الصَّابِرُونَ أَجْرَهُمْ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. That those individuals who are patient, those individuals who give thanks to Allah in their patience, they will be rewarded from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without stint, without any shortcomings, without any decrease, diminution whatsoever on the reward. So we not only get the salawat from Allah for being thankful, we not only get the rahmah from Allah for being thankful, we also get a reward that has no limit whatsoever. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he has told us that the affairs of the believer are amazing. All of them are amazing for the believer. And this is only for the believer. Only for the believer. And what is that? And that when he is given some felicities, he's thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that's good for him. And when he's touched with some type of calamity or misfortune, he's patient, and that's good for him. This is only for the believers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The believers, the true believers. That any time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed that you get a $60,000 raise, you thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's good for you. But at the same time, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tries you, by not only giving you a demotion, you lose your job, you stay unemployed for 5, 6, 7, 8, 10 years, you lose your limbs, which gives you the ability to even practice the job and perform it, even if you had a job. You're patient with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you're thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, and that is also good for you. And this is also good for you. So in conclusion, brothers and sisters in Islam, this issue of being content with the decree of Allah and what He has determined is extremely important for us. If we want to be with those individuals whom the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, they are ashaddun nas bala', they are the most severe in test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we need to learn how to be content with whatever Allah has decreed. We need to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those whom are content and pleased whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed. And we need to be thankful to Him, not having any displeasure, no displeasure whatsoever, no displeasure whatsoever, which is very difficult. And we should ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep on our tongues the tasbih, the tahmid, the tahleel, the takbir, the saying subhanallah, the saying Allahu Akbar, the saying Alhamdulillah, the saying La ilaha illallah, for surely, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالْخَوَاتِيمِ, that actions are based on the last thing you do. Actions are based on the last thing you do. Remember this. Whatever you get caught doing at the time of your death, this is going to be a major determining factor of where you're going to go. إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالْخَوَاتِيمِ, actions are judged by the last thing you do. Think about being displeased while being shot, being displeased with the decree of Allah and someone accidentally shoots you. Think about being displeased with the decree of Allah and someone stabs you. Think about getting hit by a car at the moment that you're displeased with the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you've heard something about your wife dying or your husband dying or you're losing a job or you've been afflicted with some disease and you're displeased with the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you die at the stake. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, brothers and sisters in Islam, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those people who are patient with His decree. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those who are content and pleased with the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we do this, when a misfortune befalls us, Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, whoever has this patience, whoever is pleased, Allah yahdi qalbahu. Allah guides his heart. Meaning Allah makes him fully aware that this thing could not have hit me if it was supposed to pass me by. And it could not have passed me by if it was supposed to hit me. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين أجمعين في كل مكان سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. Anything that I said that is correct is from Allah. Anything that I said that is incorrect is from myself and or from Shaytan. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله.
We do a few question answers. No. Yes. No.
Inshallah.
Inshallah, we'll take a few questions and ask a few questions. On the related to the topic only, inshallah ta'ala. Yes.
I'm trying to understand, like, suicide. How is that, you know, tied in with the covenant of Allah? I was reading a book the other day, and it's something I read, said something about the shaitan suggested suicide. And me and my wife had gotten to it. She had asked me, and I was like, I couldn't explain it to her. Can you help me out with that?
The brother's asking the question about suicide, and I'm not absolutely, I don't fully understand exactly what he means, but I think what your brother means is, and you can correct me, alhamdulillah you're sitting right here, that how do we understand suicide in terms of the decree of Allah? This is really interesting that you ask this for two reasons. Number one, I happen to be right now going into the fourth week of the Maryland State Police and Correctional Officers Training Academy, going through the same training that they go through. And one of the issues that we had to study about and be tested on, which deals with inmates, is suicide. And it was very interesting. I never knew some of these things existed in the theoretical aspects of suicide and why people commit suicide, what makes them even think about committing suicide. And the second thing is that a very good friend of mine, a Muslim, just a few weeks back, tried to commit suicide. And I was very shocked that he tried to do this, because outwardly he seemed very stable. And one of the things that we learned in the training academy about suicide is that one of the signs of suicide is the person becomes extremely happy. And that seemed kind of funny to me. What they meant by this was that the person becomes extremely happy after having a lot of remorse and a lot of frustration, and sometimes they go into delirium. They call it DTs, delirium tremens, delirious tremors. They said that they become happy because they finally resolved in their minds that I'm ready to do it. So you see them becoming very happy. You see? As for the decree of Allah, everything is a decree of Allah. If it happens, it's the decree of Allah. Suicide is no different. The point is, though, is that some people, they try to attribute this to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is the one who created us, and he created what we do and what we think. But Allah is not the reason that the person wants to commit suicide. There's a difference. Allah created us, and he created what we do. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't order us to commit suicide. As you said, this is from shaitan or our nafs whispering to us. We don't blame this to Allah. Or we don't blame this on Allah. We don't attribute the sharr, the evil, to Allah. All the good is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But it's in the book that is above the throne with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the lawh al-mahfuz, that person on that day at 11:37, he was going to take himself and throw himself out on the subway train tracks. It was written. Now, how do we avert this? We avert it. One of the ways we avert it is by asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us pleased with whatever he decrees. Because people who want to commit suicide, as we learned in the training academy, they have many reasons. Number one, as they mentioned, some people commit suicide because they're gambling with death. They want attention. They said this usually happens from the women more than the men. They take a lot of pills because they want attention from their... and get my stomach pumped. and he'll love me more, or he'll divorce his other wife. This is one of the reasons. One of the other reasons is because people and their family try to use them as a scapegoat. If it wasn't for you, we wouldn't be in this situation. So the person becomes sad. And this is why we have to rely on the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-hamni wa huzni. Oh Allah, I seek refuge with you from anxiety and grief or sadness. We have to constantly ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, seeking refuge with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from this sadness and grief and sorrow and depression. Because these are things that increase that idea of suicide. But in a nutshell, the decree, that which is written about the person committing suicide, no one can do anything about that except the person making dua. If he makes dua and puts his trust in Allah and is pleased with the decree of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will use that dua to avert him from committing the suicide. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Now, have a moment.
Half of Dean is married, right?
No, half of Dean is married.
The Dunya's out there, right?
The Dunya's out there and in here.
And here. But I work at a job, right? And, you know, just like this poopy thing, you want to wear, but it's a thing. So I'm like struggling with that. So ignorance prevails, right? It prevails. But,
Keep asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
What do we want? The deen or the dunya?
You want a little bit of the deen to help you get to the next life.
Not the dunya.
Not the dunya. I should say, excuse me, a little bit of the dunya to help you get to the next life.
Allah to get the share.
Yes, that share is going to help you get to the next life.
Don't be
mad, right? Right. Allah Akbar. There's a question on a note, and we see this hand over here. Is the sin that one may fall in a calamity, I'm not understanding it, but it seems as though it's saying that is it a sin that one may fall in a calamity? I don't understand, but I'll try my best. If you're saying that is sin a calamity or a trial, not a calamity but a trial, absolutely. Sin is a trial. A person who has a drug problem, a Muslim who has a drug problem, a Muslim who has a problem sleeping with women or chasing women, a Muslim who has a problem sleeping with men who are not her husband, a Muslim who has a problem smoking cigarettes, these are all trials from Allah. We can't say they're not. Even though they're sins, they're still a trial. They're still a trial. Allah tries us with the good and the evil. And this is one of the reasons why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, going back to what the brother said about suicide, as far as dua is concerned, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that if you see somebody who's going through that trial, smoking cigarettes, using drugs, whatever, some disease, you should say, Alhamdulillahi alladhi a'afani mimma batalaka bih wa faddalani ala kathir mimma khalaqa tafdila aw kama qalahu sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, you should say, praise be to Allah, who has pardoned me and protected me and given me security from what you are being tested with. And you don't walk up to them and say this to them. You say this, you know, to yourself. Oh, Alhamdulillah, for the one who has protected me and given me security from what you're being tested with, and has preferred me and given me excellence over most of what he has created. He said, if you say this dua, then that thing that person is being afflicted with won't happen to you. See, this is another way the dua is used to keep us. The person wants to commit suicide. We know he can be tried to commit suicide. We make this dua so it won't happen to us. These duas, brothers and sisters in Islam, will help us. They will help us. to have the contentment of Allah. Another example. We know the dua that the Prophet ﷺ used to make when he used to leave his house on a trip. سبحان الذي سخر لنا هذا وما كنا له مقرنين وإنا إلى ربنا لمنقلبون. And then he used to say, اللهم إنا نسألك في سفرني هذا البر والتقوى ومن العمل ما ترضى. Oh Allah, we ask you for taqwa and birr, for righteousness and piety on this trip of ours. This is what we ask you, O Allah. Allahumma. And from the actions that you are pleased with. Allahumma. Hawwin alayna. Safarana hadha. Watwi lana bu'dahu. O Allah, make the trip short for us. Make the trip easy and short for us. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min wa'asa'is safar. O Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, I seek refuge, Allahumma anta sahibu fi safar wal khalifatu fi ahl. O Allah, you are the companion on this trip in a manner that only Allah knows. And you are the khalifa for my family while I'm on this trip. You see the word? Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min wa'asa'is safar. O Allah, I seek refuge with you from the calamities of this trip. From the calamities of this trip. Listen to the next word. وَكَآبَةِ الْمَنْظَرِ. And seeing some distressful scene on the road. You see? All of these things are sister in the decree of Allah, whatever happens, so we'll be pleased with it. We have to implement these dua, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. The next question, make dua to remove the distress and take the burden. Oh, if we should be pleased and content with the decree of Allah, does that mean if we suffer a calamity or test that we should not make dua to remove the distress and take the burden away of we are feeling? No, it doesn't mean that. We should ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to remove whatever affliction we have from ourselves or our families or our loved ones. But at the same time, we shouldn't be displeased with the occurrence of what was written, of which could not have passed us by no far stretch of the imagination. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written it. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows it to happen, we have to be pleased with the occurrence of it happening. At the same time, be patient in it. Thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and try and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to remove it. And Allah knows best. Yes.
You mentioned a little bit earlier that you wouldn't allow those people you should go through trials and tribulations. What's your thoughts on God's rejection?
The brother's asking the question that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we should...
You mentioned a little bit earlier that when Allah loves the people...
When Allah loves the people, He afflicts them. And then he asked, what about the Muslims in Bosnia? And those other places near Bosnia and other places in the Muslim world. Of course, this topic is about the contentment of the decree of Allah. And the statement that we made that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He loves the people, He tests them. This is only one part of what we're tested by Allah with. Allah also punishes us for sins. So sometimes, unfortunately, some Muslims confuse being punished by Allah as being a test from Allah. No, you know when Allah is testing you. Because there's only three receipts in this life. You know, when you go to the store, you get a receipt. Well, you should get a receipt, right? You buy some milk or some bread or something, they give you a receipt. There's only three receipts in this life. Either the receipt of a reward because you've done something good, or the receipt of a punishment because you've done something bad, or you're being tested by Allah. That's it. You're being tested by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as He does all of His creatures. And you know when you're being punished. You can't say that you're not, you can't say it's a test. You know when you're being punished. Because you did something wrong. It's just that simple. You did something wrong, so Allah is punishing you. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran that corruption has appeared on land and sea. Fil barri wal bahr. That corruption has appeared on land and sea. And this is one of the reasons why we have corrupt Muslim leaders. This is another part of the affliction. Because of our sins, we have corrupt Muslim leaders. Allah gives us a corrupt leader because of our sins. It's because of us. So He puts over us a corrupt person. And look out through the Muslim world. I can't say all of them are corrupt, but I would say safely that a lot of them are corrupt. Allah knows best. You know, I can't say all of them. Only Allah knows if all of them are. But for sure, a lot, you know, there's quite a few of them that are corrupt. Why are they corrupt? Because the Muslims are sinners. We're corrupt. And we deserve it. We deserve it how? We deserve it because it's the decree of Allah. And if it didn't happen, He wouldn't have given it to us. That means we deserve it. So as far as those people overseas, and the Muslims here, in Bosnia, in Kashmir, in Sri Lanka, and all those places where Muslims are being tortured and oppressed, Algeria, etc., I can't say that they're being punished. But I do know that if you disobey Allah and you leave the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you deserve to be punished. I do know that. I can't say that they're being punished, but I can definitely say that anybody who deserts the Quran and deserts the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they deserve to be punished. They deserve to be punished. And there's an unauthentic hadith that says that they said that the Messenger of Allah said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and I seek refuge with Allah from lying on the Messenger of Allah, using unauthentic hadith. And I'm not using this as a proof. I'm using this, they call this istishhad. I'm not using it istishlalan. I'm using it istishhadan. I'm using it to bear witness because the statement is true. There's a statement that they attribute to the Messenger of Allah in this unauthentic hadith that they say he said, "Yati ala nas zaman." There shall come a time on the people. There shall come a time on the people. La yabqa min al Islam illa ismuhu, wa la yabqa min al Quran illa rasmuhu. To the end of the unauthentic hadith. That there's going to come a time on the people that nothing will remain of Islam except its name. And nothing will remain of the Quran except the script. Meaning the people won't be practicing it. Right? So I know that there are some Muslims in other places in the Muslim world, they're not practicing Islam. They have the Quran, they have the masahif, the copies of the Quran in their homes. But when you look at them, you can't even tell them from the kuffar. By the way they look, by the way they dress, by the way they eat, by the way they sleep. People who do this, they're either A, being punished by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or they're being tested by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Either way it goes, it's the decree of Allah. They should ask Allah to remove the stress, remove this stressful situation from them and from all of us, because they're all of us, they're Muslims. At the same time, be content with whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed. He's saying that Sheikh Jamaluddin Zarbozo says that even in the punishment there's a test. Even in the punishment there's a test.
I got a question.
No.
Like you wear your kufi, right? It's a lot of people that wear kufi. Like if he puts them, he say, "Assalamu alaikum." He say, "Wait, my son." But if you're a Christian, you say, "Assalamu alaikum." I say, "Wa alaikum salam." But then when some people come and say, "Assalamu alaikum," or if it's "Salam alaikum," I say, "Wa alaikum." He say, "Try to say it," and you give them doubt. You can't push the people, you know, because if you push them, I give them doubt where I go. To knock their brains out. Then when I give them doubt, they try to corrupt me, I still give them doubt. And keep on giving them down. Keep on giving them down.
Alhamdulillah.
And keep giving them down. So not stay brain down.
Alhamdulillah. Allahu Akbar. Naam.
There was a du'a that you mentioned that you tell medical private, which is in regard to the God of Allah, and I want you to hear from that guy.
Yeah, I don't remember the dua that you say in Laylatul Qadr, but we do say, we make a dua before we go to sleep at night in the witr, in the qunut of witr, that we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep away the evil of that which He has decreed. Meaning, keep away the evil of that which, the occurrence of what He has decreed. The qada. Right? Keep us away from the evil of that which He has decreed. Allahumma ahdina fiman hadayt. وعافنا في من عاديت وتولنا مما توليت وبارك لنا فيما عاطيت وقنا شر ما قضيت وقنا شر ما قضيت. And from the evil of that which you have, the occurrence of that which you have decreed, the evil of the occurrence of that which you have decreed. You see, so this is something that we should employ, and if we don't make this dua, then Allah knows best. Maybe these things will happen to us. Allah will keep giving us these things. Now.
So, what happened with the situation that has happened to you? I mean, you're having this situation, but you still think about that situation. Like what you should have done, or what you could have done, or what you could do now. How does that situation, I mean, how does that affect?
I don't understand exactly what you mean.
That's what you're having because of Allah.
Right.
Okay, would it be not really being happy because of Allah if you were like, if you felt like you were happy because of Allah, but you kept on thinking back to what happened and what you could have done to change
that situation? The brother's asking the question that I think in a nutshell what he's asking is that you've done something, you regret doing it, right? You seek forgiveness of Allah, you make tawbah, but it keeps recurring in your mind that you did it. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
And that if I would not have done this, or I wish I would not have done this, or if I would have done this, this wouldn't have happened.
Yeah.
Yeah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's already told us about this, that we shouldn't say these things. We shouldn't say these things. We shouldn't say law. We shouldn't say if. He said because law tabtahu amal ash-shaytan. The saying if opens for the work of shaytan. Because Allah has decreed it. This is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to say in this dua that I think we can find in Mishkat al-Masabih, سبحان الله وبحمده لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله ما شاء الله كان وما لم يشأ لم يكن. Glory be to Allah and praise be to Him. There's no strength nor power but with Allah, with Him. Whatever Allah wills is, and whatever He does not will is not. Whatever He wills is, and whatever He does not will is not. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also mentions in the Quran several verses like this, or verses like this hadith. وَمَا تَشَاءُونَ إِلَّا أَنْ يَشَاءَ اللَّهُ رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ. And you cannot will unless it be the will of Allah. When Allah decrees something, something happens to us, we turn the corner with our car and we have an accident. Oh, if I would have made a right instead of a left, this wouldn't have happened to me. So this is from Shaytan. And the Prophet has forbade us not to make this statement. He said, don't say if. He says, فَإِنَّ لَوْ تَفْتَحُ عَمَلَ الشَّيْطَانِ. Don't say if. If I would have married you, I wouldn't be in this situation. No, don't say if. Because if opens up the work of shaytan.
No, that's like saying that they're not really happy.
The brother's asking, does this indicate that the person's not really happy? It's possible. It's possible. We don't want to say that it's an absolute indication that the person is not happy, because a person, the shaitan makes us say things, slips of the tongue. Oh man, if I would have done this, it's not that I'm not pleased, but it just comes out. You see? It just comes out. I should have turned right. You see? Doesn't mean that the person is displeased necessarily. Allah knows best. The person knows himself better than anyone after Allah. Now, inshallah. We mentioned it earlier, maybe you weren't here. We mentioned that there's a difference between the al-qadr and al-qada. That al-qadr is the writing down of those things. And the qada is the occurrence of those things. The occurrence of what is written. And the dua can be used by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to avert the occurrence of the qadr. You understand? Right? It's not wiping off, it's not wiping away what was written 50,000 years before creation. It's only, you're only averting that plane crash. You see? You made dua to Allah to catch that plane to go to Seattle, Washington. And everything you did kept you from catching that plane. You were rushing, speeding. Maybe I shouldn't say like O.J. Simpson, you know. But you were running down the hallways of the airport, trying to catch the plane. You did everything that you could. Everything that you could. You see? And that's why the beginning of the hadith that says, don't say if. Don't say if. The beginning of the hadith gives you more benefit in understanding that principle. The Prophet said, ihrus ala ma yanfa'uka. Ihrus ala ma yanfa'uka. He said, be zealous. Be zealous. Have a lot of energy in doing that which will benefit you. And then if something befalls you, don't say if. You see? In other words, you've done everything that you could. And remember, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as the scholars of Islam have told us, as we mentioned, there's two types of those types of decree, of the thing that's determined. There's the one that's shari'i and the one that's kawni. The shari'i ones are the ones that Allah sent down from His revelation. Those are the ones that you have no choice in. And Allah gives you the propensity to carry them out. No one can say that they don't have the ability to wear hijab. No one can say that they don't have the ability to grow a beard unless Allah created you specifically, like some people, like Malaysia, Somalia, you don't find them growing a lot of facial hair. But for those people who don't have that situation, this is maqdi shar'an. You are obligated to grow that beard. You have the propensity to grow that beard. Allah has created you with the ability to do it. And He never ever puts a responsibility on a creature unless He gives them the ability to carry it out. That's from His hikmah, His wisdom. He made the angels extremely strong and extremely fast. And He didn't give the ant and the bee the job of carrying revelation to the prophets and messengers, or the job of protecting the mu'minun in jihad. He gave that to the angels. He made them extremely fast and extremely strong. They would ask the message of Allah. وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْمَحِيدِ. They ask you about menses. The Prophet would look up, look down. Jibril brought the answer. He brought the verse to explain. They ask you about menses. They ask you about the new moon. They ask you about the qital. They ask you about this. They ask you about that. Immediately, quicker than the blink of the eye, Jibril is there. He gave Jibril, Mikael, Israfil, whatever creature He created, He gave them the propensity and the ability to carry it out. We cannot say that we cannot make 5 prayers a day. We cannot say I don't have the ability, except when Allah afflicts you with some type of sickness or something, the ability to fast in the month of Ramadan. You see? So you do everything that you can to practice this Quran and the Sunnah, everything that you can. And then if it doesn't go your way, فَقَدَّرَ اللَّهَ مَا شَاءَ فَعَلَ. This is what the Prophet told us to say. Allah has decreed it. He's willed what He does, what He wants to do. Whatever He wants to do, He has decreed it and He's willed what He's done what He has willed. And don't say if. But you can't sit around saying, I don't have the ability to do it. I can't do this. I can't take care of my wife. I can't do that. So you have to get up and strive as hard as you can to do everything that you can. And if you don't get that college degree, or if you don't marry that sister, or if you don't go to Medina to study Islam, or you don't do this, or you don't do that, then you say, Alhamdulillah, Ashkuruhullah, I thank Allah, I praise Allah, I'm pleased with the decree of Allah. I'm pleased with the decree of Allah, and you don't say if, because if opens up the door to shaitan, or shaitan, the actions of shaitan. The brother is saying that there's a narration that is attributed, and it's justifiably attributed because it is the statement of Imam Shafi'i. It's attributed to Imam Shafi'i that if this surah Al-Asr, Inna al-insana lafi khusr, if it was the only surah that was revealed, it would be sufficient for the people. Meaning, it doesn't mean that the other 113 surahs of the Quran are not sufficient. It means that that intrinsically, those aspects in those ayat have all of what the person needs to guide him to the straight way. Not that the other parts of the Quran are not necessary. Because Allah says, وَلَعَصْرِ إِنَّ الْإِنسَانِ لَفِي خُسْرٍ. All human beings are lost. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ Four aspects. Amanu, those who have correct aqidah, those who believe, those who have correct aqidah and belief. وَعَمِلَ الصَّالِحَاتِ And they do righteous deeds. And righteous deeds, of course, the ulama explains to us, what is a righteous deed? Which is that which is in accordance with the Quran and the Sunnah, and that which has a pure, clean niyyah. A pure, clean niyyah. If one half of those things is missing, it's considered an evil deed. It's not a righteous deed. وَتَوَاسَوْ بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاسَوْ بِالصَّبْرِ And that he enjoins and exhorts and encourages each, they encourage each other to the haq, to the truth of the Quran and the Sunnah, of the Quran and the Sunnah, not some other type of false truth. I don't know if we can use that, but some type of truth that seems to be the truth. And as sabr, being patient during the trials and tribulations that you are going to endure by spreading this da'wah. This is what Imam Shafi'i meant. Wallahu tabaraka wa ta'ala a'lam. He said we have to the sister's program now. Inshallah, I'd like to make one last note, and that is, brothers, inshallah ta'ala, this particular aspect of contentment, as we mentioned earlier, we know that it's difficult. We know that it's extremely difficult for us to be content with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's decree. But there's one, we don't want to call it a trick, we'll call it a hint. There's one hint that the ulama has given us in conclusion, and that is, the Sahaba of the Messenger of Allah. The brother asked the question, who we mean by the ulama? The ulama we mean here by the Sahaba. The Sahaba, one of the companions of the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ubay bin Ka'ab, one of the ulama. And when I mean ulama, I mean, in most cases, I mean the Sahaba, and I work my way down. I don't mean the people of today, I'm working my way back. Ubay bin Ka'ab, it's been reported that he has said that the meaning of the verse in the Quran, the meaning of the verse in the Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I can't remember. The verse means, the meaning of the verse is to associate with the righteous. Associate or befriend the righteous. And what he said this means is that these are the individuals whom by your association, those who understand that they should be content with the decree of Allah, it rubs off on you. If you're making your companionship people who are always whining and always crying and always hemming and always hawning and always all of these complaints, if you're associating with those type of individuals, then this will be an aid and a better to you not being pleased with the decree of Allah. So you should be around the people who are content with what Allah has decreed. In other words, as the Prophet ﷺ mentioned in the hadith, a man is on the deen of his friend. So let him be wise in whom he chooses as a friend. Because these people are going to advise you. These people, you're going to seek counsel from them. These people are rubbing shoulders with you. These are the people who are you are going to adopt some of their ways. It's a natural progression. You're going to adopt some of their ways, they're going to adopt some of your ways. Or you wouldn't be associating with them. You want to be with them for some reason. So if they are pleased with the decree of Allah, then these are the type of people we should associate with. And this is something that the ulama, the sahaba, they have left us, and there's many other things which we don't have time to go into, nor have the ability to even discuss. And so with that, inshallah, I ask you brothers to make dua for me also, down in the boondocks, and to make this burden of lethargy lifted from my shoulders so I can do some more work, inshallah. Subhanaka wa bihamdika. أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. السلام عليكم.